can. Diet sodas as part of a healthy diet help diabetics not only lose more weight, but improve health through better blood glucose control? We've been told for years diet sodas and artificial sweeteners are bad for us. What is the truth and who can we trust? The very first of its kind, a new clinical study, which we will cover today, directly compares diet sodas to water, and it's about to turn everything you know upside down. Welcome to the Resilient Diabetic. This is the channel we turn ordinary, struggling diabetics into extraordinary, well-controlled diabetics. If you are brand new to this channel, I welcome you today. My name is Jay Sampat. Don't forget to subscribe and hit that gray notification bell. That way you will be alerted when new life-changing episodes have been published. And if you have learned something new today, please smash that like button for me. As with all my videos, this should not be considered personal medical advice. This is my interpretation of the latest research. If you want medical advice, please always consult your physician. There will always be continued controversy regarding the personal benefits of diet sodas and non-nutritive sweeteners. This is a touchy subject for many, and understandably so. But what if you are a diabetic like me, who happens to be a late onset type 1 diabetic, or any diabetic for that matter, wanting to keep those blood sugars in those non-diabetic ranges, and that is between 70 to 100 all day, or an A1C in the low fives, upper fours? Can diet sodas not only help control blood sugars, but the big question today, can it make a difference to weight loss if included in a diet? I would venture to say 99.9% of the information we read and search on when it comes to diet sodas are extremely negative. What do all the headlines say? They actually claim they're not any safer than real sugar, and that they're bad for you. They'll make you fat. They'll cause cancer. Artificial sweeteners, they claim, raises your risk of heart disease. And the newest trend, it affects your gut bacteria. The thing is, 1 in 5 here in the United States consumes a diet drink on any given day. And in full disclosure, that includes me too. Although added sugars is a top health concern, diet sodas are consistently met something between distrust and hostility. The question is why? But before we do, let me give you a little history before we do get into the whys. Saccharin, which was actually named for the Latin word for sugar, was discovered accidentally in 1897 by a John Hopkins University researcher who was studying coal tar derivatives. He forgot to wash his hands before lunch and tasted something really sweet on his fingers. This is exactly how the accidental discoveries of Sweet and Low, Aspartame, and Splenda came to be. After tasting everything in his lab to determine the source, he figured out it was that coal tar derivative, which happens to be 300 times sweeter than sugar. By 1907, saccharin was already widely used in sodas and canned goods because it was far cheaper to produce than sugar. But most Americans actually had no idea it was in their food because it was not disclosed. It was then banned by Congress soon after by the lobbying efforts of the sugar industry. And this is where the manipulation of science began against all the sweeteners. What was at stake and what is still at stake? The control of the marketplace and your dollar. What can make certain chemicals taste so sweet? And is it bad for us? Because these are artificially made. The questions are not trivial. 8 out of 10 Americans now consume some sort of artificial sweetener, not just diet sodas. There are some that are strictly against the consumption of diet sodas, but do not realize the same sweeteners are in everything else they eat. Last year alone, the food industry introduced over 2,000 reduced sugar or sugar-free foods. Many of them were made with sucralose, which is Splenda. I do, however, need you to understand the difference between sugar alcohols, which come from natural sources, and artificial sweeteners, which are a type of synthetic sugar substitute created by combining chemical components in a lab. What is arguably the most important thing to know about artificial sweeteners? You consume them in teeny tiny quantities and are also known as non-nutritive or low-calorie sweeteners because they do not contribute calories to food and they do not raise blood sugars. In comparison, sugar alcohols, however, do contribute some calories to food, and depending on which ones, can and will raise your blood sugars. They are required in much larger amounts because they are also less sweet. Negative headlines will always grab your attention and you never forget them, whereas positive ones are quickly forgotten and the information you learn never gets passed on. Most, if not all, the studies done on non-nutritive sweeteners or low-calorie sweeteners are either observational studies, animal studies, or worse, in vitro studies. Let me give you a few brief examples of how the science gets manipulated. If you did a Google search on artificial sweeteners and gut bacteria, you will find a never-ending slew of articles suggesting that they can wreak havoc on your gut flora. If you took a closer look at all of the articles, they refer to one study which was carried out on a petri dish, in other words, an in vitro study. Bacteria from the gut were cultivated with human cells and then given artificial sweeteners. In vitro studies is a cost-effective technique to conduct research, but the findings must be supported by human trials to ensure the results are replicated. But when such studies were carried out on humans, scientists did not observe similar results. What is surprising, even at higher doses of sucralose, they found that artificial sweeteners do not alter the human microbe, even for a short period. But you see, you never, and I repeat this, never see or hear the real human studies. The focus, which is repeated over and over, is the first headline-grabbing, worthless study. Sweeteners such as aspartame, saccharin, and sucralose do not cause cancer. The reason behind this myth dated back to a few studies in the 1970s on rats and saccharin. First, what matters is the dose. If you give a rat the dose equivalent to us consuming an entire swimming pool worth, then it's worthless. Furthermore, scientists found male rats had a particular pH factor in their bodies, which makes them develop bladder cancer. Humans do not have this factor. Not a single human study, not one, over 40 of them, could duplicate any cancer-causing effect of the sweeteners. But you don't hear about any of those either. There have been more studies done on sweeteners than any other product you will put in your mouth. Artificial sweeteners promoting weight gain is perhaps one of the most absurd of all the misconceptions, as they are either calorie-free or low-calorie. According to these observational studies, they increase weight because they fool your brain into thinking sugar is coming in, which causes an insulin secretion and weight gain. Second, they claim these sweeteners increase appetite and cause one to eat more. And unfortunately, neither of these arguments carry weight. Insulin levels do not rise after consuming artificial sweeteners. Note, I said artificial sweeteners, not sugar alcohols. Any of us diabetics with a simple glucose meter can see that for ourselves. Although diet sodas have no calories, no sugar or fat, the most devious of these observational studies try to link the development of type 2 diabetes and heart disease to them. One study goes as far as stating that a single serving of an artificially sweetened drink per day is associated with an 8 to 13% higher risk of type 2 diabetes. And this study gets repeated ad nauseum. One very important point about observational nutritional studies. They are essentially nothing more than a survey. Researchers ask a group of participants, a cohort, what they ate and how often. Then they track that cohort over time to see if any health conditions the study participants developed. Then they try to make a link. And this is why these observational studies can't be trusted. It's purely politics and agenda at work by linking improper causes. Take type 2 diabetes, for example. We already know, modern science has already shown, that if someone consumes excessive amounts of carbohydrates, even the quote-unquote healthy ones like whole grains, around the clock, the liver has no other choice but to convert these sugars into a specific fat, which then gets stored as intra-abdominal fats, that is, fats in between the organs, fats inside the liver, fatty liver, and inside the muscle cells, resulting in insulin resistance. So it is the fats deep inside the body that you cannot see, not the ones you can pinch, that is the true cause of type 2 diabetes. Now we know the extreme limitations of these observational studies. We can cover the first of its kind, an actual clinical trial to find the truth. It's called The Effects of Water and Non-Nutritive Sweetener Beverages on Weight Loss and Weight Maintenance, a randomized clinical trial. The purpose of this trial was to directly compare the gold standard beverage for supporting good health, plain old water, against non-nutritive sweetener-based beverages in the context of weight loss. The study used a randomized equivalence design with artificial sweeteners or water as the main factor in a trial amongst 303 weight-stable people who were overweight. All of the participants had to participate in a weight loss program, plus assigned to consume either water or a non-nutritive sweetener beverage daily. Yes, I said daily, for 1 year. The participants randomized to the non-nutritive sweeteners were asked to consume at least 24 ounces of the beverage per day, and their water consumption was not restricted. Participants randomized to the water group were asked to consume at least 24 ounces of water per day and not drink any non-nutritive sweetener beverage. They could, however, eat foods that contained non-nutritive sweeteners. For example, artificially sweetened yogurt, gums, candies, cookies, ice creams, but they could not intentionally add any non-nutritive sweetener like NutraSweet, Equal, Sucralose, Splenda, Stevia to the beverages they consumed like coffee. All assessments except for height were conducted at baseline. This included body weight, waist circumference, and resting blood pressure. Blood samples were collected for measurements of lipids and blood glucose levels. Out of the 303 participants that began the study, 279 did complete the weight loss phase. And what were the results? We can start with the weekly hunger scores. In other words, the participants were asked how hungry they felt during the trial. The hunger scores were lower amongst the non-nutritive sweetener group than the water group. That could make it very plausible that the diet soda drinkers were more likely to adhere to the dietary recommendations due to less hunger. So drinking diet sodas does not make one hungrier. Dagger number one. The second bomb drop. The analysis did indicate weight loss in the non-nutritive sweetener group was significantly greater than in the water group. Dagger number two. The diet soda drinkers lost more weight. Changes in weight circumference, glucose, blood pressure, HDL were not significantly different between both groups. The one thing I want to point out, there was no change in fasting blood glucose after 52 weeks. They remain in the normal ranges for both treatment groups. The results do not support the notion that non-nutritive sweeteners hinders weight loss by disrupting normal appetite regulation and glucose homeostasis. Dagger number three. Here was the big surprise that nobody was expecting, not even me. Triglycerides were noticeably lower in the non-nutritive sweetener group. There was also a marked reduction in total cholesterol and LDL in the diet soda group than in the water group. According to the researchers, that was due to greater weight loss in the non-nutritive sweetener group. Why would the researchers downplay or evade this last mind-blowing point? Either they are pressured to cover up the truth, or they do not want to disturb the hornet's nest of our governing health organizations who have a very pro-carbohydrate, anti-fat, anti-protein agenda. The science of nutrition is all politics. In my humble opinion, because the participants were able to consume diet sodas on a daily basis, that gave them the pleasure of tasting something sweet. So they unintentionally ended up eating less refined sugars and carbohydrates as a whole. For those of you who may not know, there is a direct correlation between triglycerides and carbohydrate intake. As one drops carbohydrates, the triglycerides in the blood will also drop. This study demonstrated what we as diet drinkers already knew. We can safely drink non-nutritive sweetener-based beverages without concern on our blood sugars. Furthermore, weight loss efforts will not be undermined and, in fact, may be slightly enhanced as long as one is concurrently consuming a nutrient-dense diet. I bet you would love to learn more on the subject of nutrition and diabetes, so I'll create two links for you. The first thing you will see is to subscribe to this all-important life-changing channel. The second link you will see will be a playlist on diabetic weight and fat loss episodes. So have a great and productive day, and we will see you soon with another new episode, which are generally released weekly. Bye for now.